Well, we are exactly 3 weeks away from the general election, the first date of polling on the 11th of April. And as we count down to that first phase of polling, there is a lot happening politically, especially with regard to alliances. The NDA clearly seems to be ahead at the moment. Amit Shah and Narendra Modi managing to stitch up alliances in crucial states ahead of the polls. But the Congress somewhat faltering on that front. Someone who's been very outspoken in his criticism of the way in which the opposition is handling all of this, and the Congress in particular, is former finance minister and former leader of the BJP, Mr. Yashwant Sinha, who joins us now on NDTV. Mr. Sinha, thank you for speaking to us. You were very frank and blunt in some of your tweets over the last couple of days, where you have said that you're giving unsolicited advice to Rahul Gandhi. Please finalize your alliances in Bihar, Jharkhand and Delhi and elsewhere today. It is already too late. If you could sort of expand on that, sir, about why you're giving this unsolicited advice.
Well, the opposition parties, first of all, must realize that they are up against a very wily and perhaps even oily adversary. I mean, they will, Amit Shah and Modi will stop short of nothing in order to win the election, and that's very evident in the manner in which they have stitched up their alliances. The BJP has given up winning seats where they had sitting members of parliament. They have compromised with political parties which were extremely critical of them. So they have not stood on any sense of prestige. They have swallowed the bitter pill and gone for alliances. On the other hand, as I said in my tweet, the opposition parties which don't hold the seat, which were perhaps number two, number three, even number four, are making even those seats a matter of life and death, as if the entire future of the country depends on whether they contest that particular seat or not. This is what disappointed me, and that's why I came out with that tweet. And also, you know, in the process, they are muddying the waters. They are accusing each other of whatever and spoiling the entire atmosphere. First, the Mahagathbandhan has not taken place. There is no Mahagathbandhan because there is no national level alliance. There were supposed to be state level alliances, and one didn't mind that there could be state level alliances, but even there, they are faltering. And as you said in the beginning, if elections are just round the corner, the first date of the poll is 3 weeks away, then shouldn't we all ready to be able to go into the poll battle with all guns blazing?
Well, it's interesting, you know, that you're saying that, you know, and I presume you're referring largely to the Congress when you're talking about, you know, this fight over some seats, which, as you said, they're making a life and death issue and ultimately muddying the waters. Now, Akhilesh Yadav, interestingly, has said in the recent days that the Congress merely wants to save itself. It doesn't want to defeat Mr. Modi. Do you agree with that that statement, Mr. Sinha, that there is a sort of a buzz now that the Congress seems to be working more for the next general election and less for this one, which is a charge not just Akhilesh Yadav has made. Arvind Kejriwal has been very disappointed with how things are playing out in Delhi. He says that the Congress is ending up helping the BJP.
You know, I will tend to agree partially with them because all said and done, except for the Congress, every other party in the opposition is a regional party today, confined to one state, one and a half states, two states. Now, Congress party is the only party which is a national party. They may not have won many seats in the last Lok Sabha elections, but they are still a national party, and therefore greater responsibility attaches to the Congress party. They have much greater responsibility on their shoulders to see that the alliances are stitched up even at the loss of one or two seats. But that kind of leadership role has been found wanting in many areas, including Bihar, Jharkhand, Jammu and Kashmir, UP, Punjab, Haryana, whole lot of states where, even West Bengal, where they could have stitched up alliances with some of the other parties. And then we are losing time.
Would you say that as things stand today, it is advantage NDA in these elections, particularly after Balakot?
Not at the level of the people, but in terms of alliances, BJP has certainly done better than the parties in the opposition. When the election season was approaching, everyone believed that the opposition parties will tie up the alliances very soon. In fact, the outlook was that the NDA will come apart. But NDA has not come apart. NDA has held together strongly thanks to the leadership that BJP has provided. Whereas there has been absence of leadership, there has been absence of intermediaries who could resolve difficult issues, and there has been delay. So that is something which is causing disappointment even amongst people who want to vote for the opposition parties.
Why do you think that's happening, though, Mr. Sinha? I'm sorry, just to ask you on this, why do you think that the Congress is sort of, in a sense, what you're suggesting is sort of walking down a path of political suicide in this election? Why do you think that is happening? Is it Rahul Gandhi's inability to stitch up alliances the way that his mother has been capable of in the past? What is your reading?
I can't really, you know, I'm not aware of the internal dynamics of the Congress party. So it's difficult for me to comment on this. But, you know, I'm just looking at the results, that if their alliances are not getting formed, then obviously there is something which is holding it up. And the only thing that can hold it up is the insistence that, you know, we must fight on this seat or these seats, and we'll not give it up, and that is causing the problems. In fact, I had suggested some time ago that even if they have major difference of opinion, let's say on one seat, they are not able to come to an agreement, let them have a friendly fight, but let's not ruin the prospects of the non-BJP candidates in, let's say, 40 seats in Bihar or 39 seats in Bihar, because you are not able to come to an agreement with regard to one seat. So it's that kind of spirit of accommodation which is needed.
The spirit of accommodation. Then do you think, for instance, sir, that in a crucial state like UP, where you have the SP-BSP alliance on one hand, and then you have the Congress, which is, you know, fighting on its own and says it's leaving seven seats for them, etc., and you have Priyanka Gandhi Vadra now campaigning the way she does, do you think that's actually going to eat into the BSP-SP vote?
That depends. You know, for UP, the way things have worked out, my very strong recommendation to the Congress party, the SP and the BSP is, please reach a tactical understanding. Because the Congress party has the capacity to wean away votes from the BJP. These two parties, BSP and SP, have core voters. They have committed voters. Which they may not, the Congress party may not be able to influence. But they certainly are in a position to influence the BJP votes. And therefore, the three parties should sit together and reach an understanding, even an understanding which need not be, you know, in the media or in
more
the public domain.
More tactical than anything
else. Just quietly reach an understanding.
Mr. Sinha, then one has to ask about the opposition's narrative for, you know, even though the opposition seems so disjointed, as you're pointing out. Now, I know that you are someone who has sort of been in the forefront in raising the Rafal issue as well. But do you feel that the opposition is making a mistake in not really highlighting the issue, for instance, of unemployment the way that it should be? I mean, look at today's headlines. The national male workforce is shrinking. That is what the NSSO report also pointed out, the same report that the government has been trying to bury for months now, which says that unemployment is at a 45-year high. Now, aren't these the issues on which the opposition really needs to go to town and sort of flag way more than Rafale or anything else?
Absolutely. I mean, opposition should raise many issues, but they should be able to pick up the more important issues which were influencing the people earlier and will influence the people even later, especially during the elections. And unemployment, with the latest data which has been brought forth, is clearly one of the topmost issues which should be raised, and they should make the life of the government miserable on this issue. The government is coming out with one lie after another on this, one untruth after another. Finance minister is, given his probably health concerns, is writing blogs every day and getting a lot of traction in the media. But this has to be met. The opposition party leaders must go right down to the grassroots level, tell people how the youth have in this country have suffered, how crores of jobs, in more than 4 crore jobs have been lost in 4 years, instead of 2 additional crore jobs being created. Now, these are things which will count with the people. And it's not the Congress party or SPBSP which is saying it. It is the NSSO data which said it, and that data was suppressed. It was not allowed to be published.
What do you think, Mr. Sinha, then, of you're just staying with this issue of unemployment? The CII report, which said that there was a surge in job creation in India's small and medium businesses over the last several years, that they had grown by some 14% from 2014 onwards, the first 4 years of this government. Now, that is presenting a very rosy picture on the jobs front compared to the NSSO report and what the CMIE and others are saying.
Nidhi, let me say this to you. I would hold anything coming from a corporate house or a confederation of corporate houses with a great deal of suspicion. They do what the government tells them to do, you know. So the government will say, come out with this figure, and no corporate house or no corporate house association will have the courage to stand up to the government. This is the tragedy of our country. They don't speak the truth. And then it is all manipulated and presented in a manner in which, there is no issue on the jobs. And why only blame the corporate houses? Look at the way the chartered accountants have responded to the points made by 108 economists from India and abroad on the job situation. So the government of the day has the power to influence such people who are prepared to be influenced to put out a different narratives, which is not based on truth.
Are you a little amused that you have chartered accountants now saying that economists are wrong on the economy?
Yes, absolutely. You know, I mean, the chartered accountants have their job cut out. Why should they delve into these issues is baffling.
Well, Mr. Sinha, finally, let me ask you, the political narrative, again, coming to this issue of the opposition sticking to the narrative of jobs. On the other hand, we have had this Balakot airstrike. The BJP is clearly, focused on the issue of nationalism and now the Chowkidar slogan that the BJP is really playing up in the last few days. How do you think that is going to play out? National security, and linked to that then this whole Chowkidar slogan?
The reply to this question is very simple. I had written a blog for NDTV some days ago in which I had said that the questions that the opposition and every right-thinking person in this country should be asking is, why did Pulwama happen? Or why was Pulwama attack, terrorist attack, allowed to happen? It is bristling with all kinds of questions. We should be asking those questions of the government. Why did Pulwama happen? Why was the life of 41 soldiers sacrificed? That is the issue. We should not get into this. Congratulate the Air Force for carrying out the attack on Balakot, and that is all very good, but why did Pulwama happen? And why did Pathankot happen? Why did Nagrota happen? Why did Uri happen? And ultimately, why did Pulwama happen? And if you look at it, there have been a string of very horrible terrorist attacks against the security forces of this country, including the army. And now suddenly they wake up and say that, we are the bravest of the lot, and look, we have carried out an airstrike. Fine, you have done it. But when China, on the other hand, prevents a proposal to go through in the United Nations Security Council, you don't even have the courage to mention China by name. Now, all these things should be taken to the people of this country, and in order to convince them that there is an electoral strategy or narrative, and there is a real narrative which is directly touching the lives of the people.
Then do you think that slogans like, chaukidar chor hai, main bhi chaukidar, that these are slogans that are only
most
really
irrelevant.
On both sides, I'm asking. These are only social media slogans, you think, at the end of the day?
No, it is. They're trying to get the opposition and others involved in a discussion of this. I am also a chaukidar. Don't get involved in this. These are totally irrelevant issues.
Final question.
I mean, we have not talked about the farmers.
You're right.
Look,
I mean, farmer distress and
condition in which the farmers are.
No, absolutely. Mm. Farmer distress and unemployment perhaps being the most important issues as far as this election are concerned. Mr. Sinha, thank you for joining us today, giving us your perspective on the political situation. Thanks very much for joining us.